Audible Inc. presents The Story of Purpose, written and narrated by Joey Reiman.
Foreword. A foreword should have a distinctive purpose, a reason for the reader to spend his or her time and hard-earned money for a book. That's why I agreed to write this one for thought leader and purpose visionary Joey Reiman, who I once referred to as the Moses of marketing. As a professor of marketing at one of the most prestigious business schools in the world, the Kellogg School of Management at Northwestern University, I have seen marketing models come and go. This one is here to stay. Beyond wealth creation and shareholder value is an unlimited resource to create a better world and a lasting legacy for business people around the globe. It's called purpose. Although the concept of purpose is not new, Joey Reiman's application and its promise for business are. No longer can pure profit be the sole reason for business creation. Capitalism needs a reset and purpose, or soulful excellence, as Reiman calls it. Purpose is the catalyst that can reinvigorate and empower capitalism. Marketing will benefit greatly as brands take stands in a world that will no longer stand for a glut of commoditized products and services without meaning. This is not a warning for marketers, but an opportunity. First, there was the product benefit. Then came the emotional benefit. Reiman and I, along with others, now herald in societal benefit that organizations are capable of delivering when they believe they have a greater responsibility in the world. These purposeful brands and companies will indeed transform society by using the power of business to mitigate the ills of the world, such as hunger, poverty, injustice, and the deterioration of the environment. No other sector in society has the means to do so. It's up to us, to you. This book shows you how to do it. Reiman provides a striking and time-tested methodology for uncovering what he calls the master idea of a brand or company. It is based on the compelling notion that companies don't live in the past, but that the past lives in them. Their foundational character, once uncovered, reveals a path to a more engaged workforce, more innovative products and services, more committed customers, dramatic increases in profits, and positive societal impact. Great riches, or the richness of life, can define wealth. Reiman says you don't have to choose. The only choice you have to make is whether you take part in the most promising business story in recent times. I now join Joey Reiman and his purpose to share the story of purpose. We hope you will make it your business to share it with every company on earth. Philip Kotler, S.C. Johnson & Son Professor of International Marketing at the Kellogg School of Management, Northwestern University, Evanston, Illinois. Author of Up and Out of Poverty, Corporate Social Responsibility, Social Marketing, and Marketing 3.0. Preface. The story of purpose is the next remarkable chapter for business. In this new era, purpose and meaning make for better brands, brighter companies, and lasting legacies for everyone involved. I've spent decades consulting to many of the leading purpose leaders and top companies around the globe. As a result of my experiences, I wrote this book for individuals who want to elevate the role of business. My goal is to align companies with higher purpose, to become part of a vanguard of visionaries who will transform society through the work of business. Throughout history, people have desired meaning as much as money. Companies are now feeling that same desire, and business is bringing it on. Beyond shareholder value are unlimited resources created by businesses working towards greater purpose. This book is the culmination of 17 years of purpose theory, modeling, and application that global giants such as Procter & Gamble, McDonald's, Carlsberg, and Newell Rubbermaid are now using with great success. My purpose and the mission of this book is to inspire you with the work of the world's most famous companies and equip you with the tools and strategies you need to make your organization as successful and respected as they are. Whether you are a student of business, an associate in a firm, an entrepreneur, or a chief executive officer, you will want to take part in this story. Our journey begins at business's new dawning and enters the offices of the world's most purposeful leaders, brands, and companies to discover best practices of purpose-inspired business. You will learn how to excavate, articulate, and activate purpose in your organizations. And by doing so, your organization can realize financial returns more than 1,000% better than S&P 500 companies. You will discover a whole new language for marketing as we move from brand to stand, point of difference to point of view, big idea to master idea, and the new ROI, return on inspiration. You will find out what kind of organization you are working in, a plantation, a castle in the sky, fortress, or if you are one of the fortunate, the idyllic and coveted Camelot companies. If you are not, you will learn the path to get there. Most important, you will recognize the power you and your organization have to affect society in a positive and meaningful way. The story of purpose shares the directions to the most exciting time and place in business and compels you to become a lead character in the story. Part 1. The purpose. Put humanity back in business. Focus on the next quarter century, and the next quarter will be just fine. Joey Reiman on his economic outlook. Aristotle called it the whatness. Nietzsche called it the why. Disney called it magic. Kennedy called it the moon. Since the dawn of human thought, purpose has guided us, inspired us, and given us reason to believe in something greater. Until now, purpose was associated with religious belief, membership in groups, dedication to a cause, and life values. But if we accept the fact that purpose is a universal force, then we must acknowledge its positive presence everywhere. Purpose is no longer confined to private reflection. It's what liberates public life. Part 1 of The Story of Purpose sets the scene for a new transformation of business. It's an adventure story where purpose is the hero, society is at stake, and business saves the world. Purpose is the force that has the ability to tip the scales and shift from a business model that is self-serving to one that serves others. We will now witness how companies, brands, and leaders who wield purpose win on Main Street, Wall Street, and their own street, garnering the devotion of their associates. Commerce will move from transactions to transformations, from competing to cooperating, from holding its hand out to becoming a helping hand. In this way, the 21st century organization will put humanity back in business. Introduction. Maybe stories are just data with a soul. Breen Brown. Can business save the world? I've pondered this question for years and find that it has always remained core to a company's purpose. Against the backdrop of international terror, teetering economies, a compromised climate, and a crisis in meaning, I witness every day how business is coming to the rescue. As the chief executive officer of the global consultancy Brighthouse and professor at the Guazzetta School of Business at Emory University, I have studied for more than 30 years what makes certain companies and brands flourish. And I have consistently found that the best companies are the ones that want to make the world more successful. Pioneering the fields of ideation and neuroscience, I have set my sights on what I call the unified theory of purpose and how business can apply it to make great contributions to humankind and all species. As a key advisor to Procter & Gamble, McDonald's, and other corporate giants, I have witnessed a superior level of leadership driven by higher callings in the world. I have concluded that the higher the individual or company's purpose, the higher his or her profit. Purpose is both a financial and humanitarian force. Purpose-driven organizations create more good in the world, which begets greater profit, which allows them to create even more good. It's a virtuous, never-ending circle. Until now, the goal of business has been business, to improve the bottom line and make shareholders rich. But a movement is afoot today, one that's led by a new vanguard of business leaders who believe in a greater purpose for business, to make the world a richer and more meaningful place to live. The story of purpose is the story of this revolution and a growing list of leaders, companies, and brands that believe the business of business is to expand its reach and role for the betterment of society. Part of my inspiration for telling a story rather than presenting just observations comes from the whimsical New Yorker cartoonist Roz Chast, whose cartoon titled Story Template illustrates the four elements of story. Once upon a time, suddenly, luckily, and happily ever after. You're welcome to download figure 1.1. Once upon a time, there was a Big Bang, a cosmic event that illustrates the power of purpose. Intent and contribution, the two characteristics of purpose, expand our universe and make important contributions, including the galaxies, the stars, the planets, and even you and me. Suddenly, in the 21st century, the world loses purpose. Terror is rampant. Warming is global. Money is scarce. And meaning? The answer to questions such as, why are we here? Is elusive. By the end of the century, people lose trust in their leaders, icons, and institutions. Luckily, the institution of business comes to the rescue and focuses on creating happier, healthier people rather than just profits. Goodness is the new currency of business. A better world is the bottom line. Happily ever after, humanity reaps the rewards. Like our ever-expanding, purpose-driven universe, business growth shows no limitation to making positive contributions to all 7 billion people and the planet they inhabit. Whether you are an astrophysicist or a marketing director, you will find that purpose creates our world. There was intention behind each contribution throughout the ages. Whether it is the stars above us or the cells within us, the powerful force of purpose is at work. This is its story. As Emory University professor Corey Key says, intention without contribution is blind, contribution without intention is impotent. Story is therefore the new narrative for business. Stories shape our lives because we are why-seeking creatures. They can also tell us about the purpose of our work. Mission is a what. Vision is a where. And purpose is our why. When members of organizations employ greater meaning, people don't get fired. They get fired up. Brands with purpose become stands. The workforce becomes a life force. Purpose teaches us that positive cause creates positive effects, and a good story is good business. The story of purpose is a compass for a new direction in business. It provides the roadmap that will guide you in building a purpose-inspired company or brand. Using a proven and proprietary methodology and framework that has been employed by the world's most purposeful companies, you will discover your authentic purpose. It's a journey that will excavate your company's past, the fruits are in the roots, and present a truer, more modern version of your organization for today's meaning-starved marketplace. There has never been a more exciting time to be in business, because business is now part of every human endeavor. Imagine if we all worked on purpose. It would be like experiencing the Big Bang for the second time. Chapter 1. The purpose of work is to work on purpose. Meaning makes money. Joey Reiman contemplating the story of purpose. From the Ten Commandments to David Letterman's top 10 list, human beings have always enjoyed making lists. Guest lists, to-do lists, best dress lists, and bestseller lists are just a few of the entries on the laundry list of lists. But only one list keeps score of the capitalism race, the Fortune 500, the annual list that ranks the top 500 U.S. companies by revenue. Created in 1955 by Fortune magazine's editors as an internal resource for writers and columnists so they'd know which companies to focus on, the Fortune 500 has been the list to get on and stay on. This list is supposed to highlight the changes and trends that are reshaping corporate America. And that is precisely why this list is defunct. The Fortune 500 was created in 1955, a time of prosperity and optimism in America. Business was in business for business and was putting shareholder value first. Revenue and profit at any expense helped build companies like GM, ExxonMobil, and Walmart, the only three companies to make the number one spot on the list. The American dream promised, if you focused your business on the bottom line, you could make that list. Unfortunately, when you focus only on the bottom line, everyone races to the bottom. And apparently, we are there. The Gallup Healthways Well-Being Index, which has been polling more than 1,000 adults every day since 2008, shows that Americans feel worse about their jobs today than they ever have before. Gallup also reports that 71% of our workforce is disengaged, and 25% of this group is what they called cave dwellers, an acronym for consistently against virtually everything. Add 10% unemployment, and we have the Greater Depression, a time where the majority of business people have jobs too small for their spirits. It's time for a new list, a new definition of success, and a new way to measure it. We need the Purpose 500, a catalog of companies that are doing well by doing good. Because it will be these companies that bring back business for good. Author Jim Collins was famous for his 1990s business manual and manifesto for greatness. If his book is Good to Great, this book could be called Great to Goodness, a story of companies that prosper for the goodness they bring to the world. How packaged goods led to packaging good. A famous quote by philosopher Aristotle tells us that where one's distinctive talents intersect with the needs of the world, there lies your vocation, from the Latin word vocare, which means to call. The story of William Proctor and James Gamble proves the Greek was right. Born in Hereffordshire, England, in 1801, William Proctor worked as an apprentice learning to dip candles. At heart an entrepreneur, he began selling dry goods and eventually opened a store in London, only to be robbed shortly after. With a huge amount of debt, but a larger amount of determination, he and his wife immigrated to the United States to rebuild. However, Proctor's wife became sick and died shortly after their arrival in Cincinnati. His dream now in the distance, William took a job at a bank. He quickly recognized a unique opportunity after learning that many of Cincinnati's candles were being shipped in from Philadelphia at great expense. With this insight and his earlier candle apprenticeship experience, he decided to start a candle business to pay off his debt. Cincinnati was a great place to make candles because of the fat and oil byproducts from the city's huge meatpacking industry. After starting his business, William would soon marry a Cincinnati woman named Olivia Norris. James Gamble was born in Grand, Ireland in 1803, and his family immigrated to America in 1819 because of the widespread depression in the British Isles following the Napoleonic Wars. They were aiming for Shawneetown, Illinois, but 16-year-old James became very ill while sailing down the same river, so they took him ashore in Cincinnati and decided to settle there. At 18 years of age, James began an apprenticeship with a soap maker and in 1828 opened his own shop. He then married none other than Elizabeth N. Norris, sister of Olivia. The girl's father, Alexander Norris, encouraged Gamble to form a joint venture with Proctor. Both men were competing for the same meatpacking byproducts to make their soap and candles, so they founded Proctor and Gamble in 1837. Now comes the good part. Working tirelessly, burning the candle at both ends, an expression that was coined much earlier in the 1600s, the Englishmen and Irishmen built a pretty sweet business, and by 1859, they had reached $1 million in sales. During the Civil War, P&G won some Union Army contracts for candles and soap, which helped them light the way for a growing business and exposed more people to the quality of P&G products. In a disparate world cloaked in darkness and disease, two men offered candles and soap. Whether this act was manufactured by money or meaning is irrelevant. The fact was, for James and William, taking care of business meant taking care of others. What's more is that in the crucible of war, they found the alchemy of good, something that could create the presence of the positive. Touching lives and improving life is P&G's purpose today. The primary way P&G fulfills this purpose is through brands of superior quality and value. P&G brands are part of people's lives. They make everyday chores such as cleaning houses and bathrooms easier and even, on some occasions, enjoyable. They make literally billions of people look and feel better every day. As you will discover, the fruits are in the roots of every great brand and Purpose 500 company. Fortune 500 companies are where money is made. Purpose 500 companies are where money goes because people like doing business with people who care about them. Giving care to the caregiver. Graco, part of Newell Rubbermaid and headquartered in Atlanta, Georgia, is the world's largest single brand of juvenile products. Their story of purpose actually defines what purpose is, an intention that creates a contribution. As we will learn, businesses without purpose might make a big profit, but brands with purpose make a big difference. Graco's story begins on a summer night in 1955, when Mr. C. Rex Thomas watched his wife reading a book while their baby was in a swing on the front porch. His wife, who was seated in the chair, had ingeniously tied a string to the swing that rocked the baby back and forth, calming him while she read. Mr. Thomas instantly recognized that his wife had developed a way to find a simultaneous moment of peace for herself and enjoyment for their child, and he set out to help her even more. He described his wife's innovation to his fellow tinkerer, Nate Saint, a mechanically gifted individual who figured out how to create a product that would do for Mrs. Thomas what she was trying to do for herself. At the same time, a church friend named Robert Cohn was looking for a proprietary product to build his company upon. He hired two men who he knew as tinkerers, Thomas and Saint. The three men met and created the mechanical version of Mrs. Thomas's handmade invention before the year was out. They called it the Swing-O-Matic. Mothers called it a gift, since it gave them the time to read a book, eat a meal, or take a bath. That is, it gave them the opportunity indeed to take care of themselves so that they could take better care of their babies. The creation of the Swing-O-Matic gave birth to a new era of parenting, as it was one of the first products to give moms and dads some time back for themselves. Graco was born on this simple idea: cradle those who cradle them. An idea that came from their origins, was conceived with intention, and made a contribution to the world. In addition, their purpose changed their customer base from babies to parents, a significantly larger market size, and refocus their acquisition strategy to parenting companies. Business increased almost 50% in 18 months. Today, the Graco brand is still rocking. Purpose brings joy to the world. The arch is an ancient symbol for a grand human achievement, a tall order for any organization, even for McDonald's golden arches. Add to that the challenge of McDonald's, the world's most advertised brand, faced in 2008 when it was spending marketing dollars and losing share in the United States. Customers not only had other choices, but fast food was fast becoming a no-go for parents seeking better nutrition for their families. McDonald's needed a new course of action, so they called Bright House. I was granted an audience with McDonald's co-founder, Fred Turner, who agreed to meet me in Las Vegas for 1 hour. Accompanied by Neil Golden, chief marketing officer of McDonald's in the United States, Turner, now in his 80s, greeted me with a 1954 playbill highlighting the jazz ensemble in which he played with McDonald's co-founder, Ray Kroc, and the woman Kroc would eventually marry. He said, "Joey, this might help you with your work. We began our careers together as jazz players." Turner's offering is music to my ears, since I know that the place where one begins always holds the seeds for future growth. Indeed, the early days of McDonald's had the exuberance of a jazz session. The company was the beat, the crew was the rhythm, and the counter was the stage for the surprise. "All of us were players that interacted with the audience," Turner recalls. Turner's insights on jazz would ultimately lead to the realization that McDonald's had lost its mojo. That surprise factor often found in jazz, where one member steps out to surprise the audience. To strike a new chord with its customers, our challenge was to bring back the joy that made McDonald's what it was. The surprise of great food, a smile, and a joyful meal. Like jazz musicians, inspired by the crowd and the beat of the music, McDonald's started to jam with their customers again. At the birth of every organization is an instructive spark of fire, like the one we found at McDonald's. Ignited by its founders, this flame lights the way forward. This starting point is a key building block for discovering your organization's guiding purpose. If you can tune into this, the rest will naturally follow. We learned over the next 16 weeks that McDonald's early days were all about delivering surprise to families with the promise of consistency. And like the sound of a jazz band, the theme of family and playing together became the primary goal. McDonald's is, in fact, a family with members worldwide in 119 countries. There's the family in the restaurant, and then there's the family behind the counter. Their job from this day forth would be to develop a truer, more modern version of their job on day one in 1955. To fill families with joy. This is what would lead the organization to a joyful meal, one that would shift their focus from toys to joys. You see, the Happy Meal made McDonald's the largest distributor of toys. Then, in one of the boldest moves since the creation of the Happy Meal, McDonald's began to offer fruit and maple oatmeal and the fruit and walnut salads, making it the largest restaurant apple purchaser in the United States. By adding fruit to every Happy Meal, McDonald's turned purpose into practice. By filling families with joy, McDonald's in the United States successfully moved from a brand that people just bought to a stand that people buy into. Joy has more dividends in profits and people. McDonald's stock had a meteoric increase, and Fortune magazine put now former chief executive officer Jim Skinner on their executive dream team. As their catchy tagline says, "I'm loving it." From brand to stand. Herders invented branding. By branding their cattle, cowboys would know what they owned. Until recently, marketing had not come much further. We were still telling consumers about the brands we owned and sold. Media were consuming consumers. About 7,500 messages bombarded us daily with promises of health, wealth, and fame. These attacks come from what we call brands. A brand is the embodiment of all the information connected to the product, serving to create associations and expectations around it. But brands are not real. Until recently, brands were created by advertising agencies for homo consumens, those who want more and use more. But the people, organizations, and those they serve are now asking a question other than how much is it? They are asking, why should I buy from you? People have taken a stand. Hence, brands have followed with something extra, an authentic purpose. Add purpose to a brand and it becomes a stand. You can download the brand stand figure. We no longer buy it, but rather we buy into it because it stands for something greater. Its barcode carries a moral code, a point of view that shares a greater purpose. Stands are created from the place of origin, not from researching the marketplace for what might sell. Stands are distinctive, creating indispensability in a competitive world. As we all want to work in a company of something greater, employees take on the role of missionaries for what they stand for. Covenants, not contracts. Promise people, not consumers. More ease, more care, and more love. Actions replace ads, eliciting relationships between giver and receiver versus seller and buyer. The best brands, those with purpose, no longer buy media, as they have created digital communities. Most exciting of all, purpose-inspired leaders are measured by their ability to transform their associates, their companies, and the world into a culture-creating place of positive presence. These Purpose 500 companies make the world a better place. Their focus is not only sharing profit, but also sharing the responsibility for a society that works better. This means acknowledging that everyone on Earth is an essential part of our collective purpose. In Martin Scorsese's Academy Award-winning picture, Hugo, the main character shares the following perspective with his friend Isabel in the clock tower of a 1930s Parisian train station. "I like to imagine that the world is one big machine. You know, machines never have any extra parts. They have the exact number and type of parts they need. So I figure if the entire world is a big machine, I have to be here for some reason. And that means you have to be here for some reason too." Such are the human beings who make up companies of purpose. The story of purpose ends a chapter for Fortune 500 companies and opens a new one for purposeful organizations that want to partner with society. "The game has changed," said Rick Gilkey, Emory University professor involved in neuroscience research in the Department of Psychiatry and a Bright House luminary. "People are not motivated by the bottom line. It's about the human factor. And purpose is the driver. It's what stirs our souls and inspires us to do great things over a sustained period of time. Capitalism, for these organizations, capitalize on human enterprise, not performance metrics. On people, not consumers. On relationships, not transactions. And on becoming the best company for the planet, not just on the planet." What is the purpose of this chapter? Point one, the purpose of business is not just to create value, but to add value to people's lives. When we do so, our companies will profit in the short term, the next decade, and the world will profit in the long term, over the next century. Point two, good and service are now the new goods and services. Point three, business is now part of every human endeavor. Purpose pointers. Move from a brand to a stand. Turn purpose into practice. When purpose leads, profit follows. Chapter 2, Purpose-Inspired Leadership. Leaders Follow People, Joey Reiman on Leadership. The purpose-driven leader puts purpose first. Becoming such a leader begins with the desire to have a purposeful life and career. Neither cornering the market nor obtaining a corner office motivates purpose-filled leaders. For them, life is not printed on dollar bills. The word motive comes from the Latin motivum, which means moving cause. A meaningful motive truly serves as the engine that fuels the purpose leader's passion. An impassioned heart is the best stimulus package. As Albert Einstein wrote, "Only those who devote himself to a cause with his whole strength and soul can be a true master. For this reason, mastery demands all of a person." The old guard leaders symbol was the yardstick that measured how much ground his employees or company lost or won. The purpose leader symbol is the compass to keep him or her heading in the right direction. Without purpose, leaders drift. With purpose, they steer. Purpose leaders believe that all people are created equally important and that equality is the glue of company solidarity. Yvonne Chouinard, founder of purpose-powered outdoor enthusiast company Patagonia, stated in Let My People Go Surfing, "The best leadership is by example. Melinda's and my office space is like everyone else's, and we always try to be available. We don't have special parking places for ourselves or for any upper management. The best spaces are reserved for fuel-efficient cars, no matter who owns them." The fact is that people want to look up to their leaders. However, they don't want those leaders to look down at them. In a story titled The Journey to the East by German-Swiss poet and novelist Hermann Hesse, a favorite story of Bob McDonald's chief executive officer of Procter & Gamble, we learn about the role of a purpose leader through a character called Leo. Leo appears to be one of the servants for the journey who, in Hesse's words, "he did his work gaily, usually sang or whistled as he went along, was never seen except when needed, in fact, an ideal servant." Throughout the book, we see Leo helping the group accomplish their journey by serving them. At the end of the journey, we realize that Leo was the actual leader of the expedition. Purpose leaders are meaning machines that make our work important instead of banal. They are dealers of hopes and dreams, and they know that they must think large if they are going to affect the world at large. There is a story that beautifully illustrates this point. Legend has it that Sony founder and CEO Akio Morita met with a small group of men in a burned-out Tokyo department store in the wake of World War II. Morita's advisors presented a strategy for building a fledgling Sony. The plan would make Sony the number one technology company in Japan. However, Morita didn't see this as his company's goal. He changed the mission to make Japan the number one technology country in the world. Most organizations today are overmanaged and underled. Purpose leaders don't manage, they mesmerize. They don't execute initiatives, they lead crusades. Their brands are not labels, but flags that should evoke the kind of patriotism we have for the countries we live in. Think about your country's flag. Then think about your company's logo. How can your logo enlist the loyalty and fervor of your national colors? These leaders want to change the way the planet works, or as Apple's Steve Jobs is widely quoted saying, to make a dent in the universe. We need more jobs. If we want to create more jobs, we need more leaders like Steve Jobs. While he was here, Jobs created a world that we had never seen before. And with that universe came new creative professions and expressions. Apple and Pixar animated entire industries, creating work for thousands and dreams for millions. Jobs gave permission to a global generation to think differently. His mixture of precision and passion created a corporate creative combustion at Apple, which formed the most valuable company on Earth. Jobs had what the Greeks considered the highest honor, kleos, remembrance in one's own time. There's been a great deal written about other purpose leaders: Southwest Airlines, Herb Kelleher, Whole Foods Market's John Mackey, Facebook's Mark Zuckerberg, GE's Jeffrey Immelt, Google's Sergey Brin, Avon's Andrea Jung, and Ben & Jerry's Ben Cohen and Jerry Greenfield. Every one of these individuals leads with plaintive purpose. Their stories are well documented in countless books and case studies. My desire, however, is to identify an unusual suspect, a leader in a company large enough.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.